Good morning, everyone. Myself, Dr. Ratima, on behalf of Dr. Lal PathLabs, invite you all for the webinar on an extended topic of in vitro fertilization. We have with us Dr. Rita Bakshi, a renowned IVF expert, and Dr. Saurabh, a cytogenetics, to represent Dr. Lal PathLabs. Dr. Rita will elucidate us on the failures involved in vitro fertilization, and Dr. Saurabh would be dealing with the diagnosis of the same. Today, in vitro fertilization is particularly a household word, but no long ago, it was a mysterious procedure, literally meaning fertilization in glass, leading to the so-called test tube babies. Out of the many causes of infertility, what are the causes that can be treated with IVF? If you and your spouse have been diagnosed with endometriosis, low sperm count, problems with the uterus or fallopian tubes, problems with ovulation, antibody problems that harm sperms or eggs, the inability of the sperm to penetrate or survive in the cervical mucus, and finally an unexplained fertility problem. IVF can be done even if a woman has had a tubal ligation reversal surgery that was not successful, woman does not have any fallopian tube, woman's fallopian tubes are blocked and can't be repaired. But IVF is a complex and expensive procedure, and only about 5% of the couples with infertility seek it out. Lewis Brown, born in England in 1978, was the first such baby to be conceived outside her mother's womb. Worldwide, more than 3 million babies have now been born through IVF. Despite the improvement in IVF technology and methods, many couples experience multiple IVF failures. Dr. Rita would be dealing with the causes of failures in IVF, and further, the possible approaches to the management of infertile couples with repeated implantation failures. Dr. Rita Bakshi, a senior IVF consultant, needs no introduction. Just to brief, she is a product of Lady Harding Medical College and has worked in renowned institutes like Safdarjung and All India Institute of Medical Sciences. She is an IVF infertility specialist and endoscopy surgeon in Delhi and the chairperson of International Fertility Center. I would welcome Dr. Rita to come on the stage and educate us on the topic. Just to brief, the online questionnaires will be handled at the end of the session. For the live audience, the questions will be handled at the end of both the sessions. Dr. Rita.
A very good morning to all of you and everybody who is connected with me on the webinar. Thank you for inviting me here, and I hope IVF is really gaining a lot of importance everywhere. And as she said, people with ligation and vasectomy and anybody and everybody today who can imagine and wants to conceive can conceive. So starting on the topic, let's look for what are the reasons for failure in IVF. Introducing the topic and knowing that IVF really, or fertility, basically involves a sperm, an egg, and a uterus. And so whatever goes wrong with the sperm will hamper whether it is natural fertility or IVF. So let's talk of sperm quality, the hormonal factors, and the sperm genetic parameters. What about the oocyte? Let's talk on the oocyte biology and what goes wrong with the egg. What about the ovarian stimulation that we use? Then, if you have a good egg and a good sperm, what about fertilization? Does anything go wrong there? And if you have a good embryo, what about implantation? Does what are the factors which go wrong with implantation? Of course, there are other factors which we'll also go along as we look at the topic. And as she said, the first baby, Louis Joy Brown, in 1978. And today we have so many millions of babies born everywhere and increasing day by day. But after each failed IVF attempt, pregnancy rates in subsequent decreased by as much as 57%, with the most remarkable decrease after the third attempt. As we said, let's look at the male parameter first. So let us look at what goes wrong with the sperm. And in addition, the other factors like female age, obesity, smoking, fibroids, thyroid, embryo transfer techniques, thrombophilia, and so many more. Endocrine factors, so we know spermatogenesis is affected by hormones which are directly released from the hypothalamus to the pituitary, and malproduction of these hormones leads to pathological changes in the male reproductive system. And since sperms never come in contact with blood, it is the seminal hormones that act on the sperm receptors. So as you can see, the hypothalamus releasing the gonadotropin-releasing hormone acting on the anterior pituitary and releasing both FSH and LH. FSH acting on the Sertoli cells, facilitating spermatogenesis, and LH acting on the Leydig cells, releasing testosterone, which inhibits gonadotropin-releasing hormone, and that's how the cycle takes place. So if in a clinical condition you have a normal spermatogenesis, that means you have a normal FSH, you have a normal LH, normal testosterone, prolactin, everything normal. What about hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism? So you find very small atrophic testes, but along with it you'll find a low FSH, a low LH, and a low testosterone. What about complete testicular failure, as occurs in hypogonadotrophy, also in prolactin secreting tumors? So anterior pituitary is releasing not only FSH, LH and the other hormones, but also thyroid and prolactin, which are also affecting the spermatogenesis. So, as we said, failure in IVF procedure can occur at different levels because of altered sperm genetics and the focus of the genomic integrity of the male gamete. This has intensified recently due to the growing concern that the genetic diseases may be transmitted via IVF. Assessment of the sperm DNA damage appears to be a potential tool for evaluating the semen samples prior to their use in IVF. There was a time when we were just doing a semen analysis, and for that also WHO has really changed parameters. Now it is the motility and the count which is more important. The morphology has taken a back seat. But the fragmentation and the DNA damage, that is looking the most important as far as semen parameters are concerned. And testing the DNA integrity may help in selecting the spermatozoa with intact DNA, with the least amount of DNA damage for use in assisted conception. And this, of course, you know, because financial, social, emotional, all problems associated with IVF and multiple attempts can be alleviated. If you look at this chart, you can see so many studies done and so many DNA assays which are there. You can see tineal, chromomycin, A3, NIC, SCSA, direct immunoperoxidase. All these tests are really testing the amount of DNA damage that can be there. And DNA fragmentation negatively is correlated with fertilization and embryo cleavage rate. Most of the studies there said that the fertilization rate is corresponding to the amount of DNA fragmentation. If you see the SCSA, the DNA denaturation that initiated no pregnancies when DNA fragmentation was more than 27%. And there was, so likewise it goes, and no pregnancy fragmentation is more than 12%. So it's so easy to diagnose and say whether a person can become pregnant or not in case of patients or in case of patients with decreased count and or no count, even azoospermic or decreased count. So it is important to know the amount of DNA damage that is there in trying to. The other thing will also come is a azoospermia factor in cases of azoospermics, which my colleague will also be talking on. So again, in azoospermics, it is trying to see whether what kind of microdeletions are there. So sperm analysis or the trying to find out the, and you'll usually see that usually failures in IVF are more because of the male part or the spermatic damage. So in azoospermic especially, there are different kinds of microdeletions, and they have been mapped around. There are parts where whether it is A or B or C. So such segments, and if it is which part, you know, when you can really say that no, this will not achieve pregnancy at all. So it is important that these recent advancements be taken into account when we are talking of the male parameter. Now coming to the oocyte, let's look at the egg. Many a time you'll find an empty follicle syndrome in which no oocytes are retrieved, which is around 0.2 to 7%. And it is important to see whether we have a good egg or not. Now, a good egg means when the egg is taken out and the follicle aspirated. So either you'll get an immature egg, like a, in prophase 1 stage, which is also called the germinal vesicle. It's an immature oocyte. The cumulus and the corona radiata are really tight together. The oocyte is of, the cytoplasm is granulated. If I just show you this picture, see, this is the kind of look of a germinal vesicle. It's a large vesicle in between, granulated cytoplasm, immature egg, presence of a, and it's a tetraploid. So it is important when the egg that you are taking out to see whether it's an immature egg or is it a mature M2, which is what we want. A mature oocyte, if I'll show you, has a cumulus, it's a sunburst appearance like this. So you can see the cumulus and the corona absolutely expanded. Cytoplasm is homogeneous. First polar body is already out, so it has, it is only half the 23 number of chromosomes. And it will arrest at this stage until fertilization will take place and will complete meiosis by expelling the second polar body only after fertilization. So this is what we want, a good egg. So we want a metaphase 2 or an M2 or a mature oocyte to take to be there if you want a good fertilization and a good pregnancy to happen. In between, of course, you have a metaphase 1 stage where you have a picture in between. So what do we see as far as ovarian stimulation is concerned? A poor ovarian response. When do we call it a poor ovarian response? What is the number? Now, the Rotterdam and the ESHRAE and American Society of Reproductive Medicine sponsored a PCOS consensus workshop 2004, and they reached a consensus in which at least two of the following features may be there: advanced maternal age more than 40 years or any other risk factor for poor ovarian reserve, but less than 3 oocytes with a convention. So when you stimulate and if you get less than 3 oocytes, you can say it's a poor ovarian reserve patient. And an abnormal ovarian reserve test, that means if you do an antral follicle count or you do an ultrasound on day 2 and you find less than 5 to 7 follicles or an AMH which is less than 0.5 to 1.1, that's the level. So if you have the AMH as low and the antral follicle count that low, and when you stimulate and you get less than 3 oocytes, you can say it's a poor stimulation. So poor response, of course, is, you can see is also related to the age when you are less than 30 or when you are more than 42. So it is very clear that the age is a big, big factor, and it's very important to counsel all girls who come there extremely career conscious, but you have to tell everybody that 35 and the ovarian reserve goes down very sharply. So it's important that one finishes the fertility career before they decide to. Of course, with cryopreservation of eggs, many girls are coming up trying to preserve, cryopreserve their eggs to be used in future. But it is important, if counseled well, that they understand this. Okay, now coming to the fertilization. So you have a good egg and you have a good sperm, yet fertilization may not take place. Failed fertilization will happen in 5 to 10% of IVF cycles and 2 to 3% of ICSI cycles. And this is a result from an impaired sperm, could be an oocyte deficiency or even a defect in vitro, the medium, the sperm or the oocyte medium that we are using. Most cases, of course, are caused by male deficiency, but it could be equal. Now, if I were to see a normal fertilization, the egg is out in the on the petri dish and the sperm is there, and you combine the two, and let's look for fertilization, is exactly looked 16 to 18 hours after insemination or after we're doing an ICSI, and the visualization of two pronuclei, when you can see both the male and the female pronuclei together and the two polar bodies in the perivitline space, then you know fertilization has occurred. Note that the two pronuclei stage will fade within 20 hours after insemination. So it's very important to time looking at the fertilization process and know. At this moment, if you say 3 pronuclei or you see an abnormal number, then you also know that this embryo is abnormal and which will again fade after 20 hours. So it is important to see fertilization exactly at the time allotted. Now, if you see this, you can see it's a day 1, 2 p.m. You can see both the pronuclei, and you can see the juxtaposed nucleoli and the two polar bodies. So if you see, these are the two pronuclei and the two all and the nucleoli and the polar bodies. So this is a day 1, 2 p.m. Nicely fertilized embryo. How do we say that's a good embryo now? So when you look at the blastomeres or the cells, if it is a grade 1, the blastomeres of equal size and regular shape. If it is a grade 2 embryo, the blastomeres of different size but of regular shape. Grade 3 blastomeres will be of equal size but irregular shape. And grade 4, the blastomeres of different size and irregular shapes. Not only is the size and the shape, but what about the fragmentation? If you see 0 to 5% is grade 1. If you see more fragment, 6 to 15, it is grade 2. 60, if it's more than 35, it's grade 5. So looking at the fragmentation, also there are some other features to be seen deciding on what quality of embryo do we have. And that is the granularity of the cytoplasm, the presence of the multinucleate cells, and the presence of vacuoles. So all these, if they are there, you can see that it will have a lower implantation rate and that will fail to cleave further. So it is important looking at the embryo. What kind of embryo do we have? If we have a grade 1 embryo and then it is not implanting, then again we look at what caused. So at every single step, we have to see what can cause failure of IVF cycle. Now why and how the implantation, why should it fail to take place? Because implantation is a key event in the establishment of pregnancy. The embryo will first come and oppose, that means just come close, then it will adhere, that's adhesion, and finally is the invasion. And as you know that the embryo has both the male and the female part incorporated in it, so it is a foreign body for the mother. And for the foreign body to be accepted by the endometrial, there has to be some kind of suppression also there so that the maternal serum does not, or the maternal environment does not recognize it as such and reject it. Now this is how, if you look at an electron microscopy, this is how a non-receptive endometrium will look like, and this is how a receptive endometrium will look like. Implantation is a critical step in the whole reproduction process, and you can see that depolarization of the embryo is also important when the embryo is about to implant. This is the bottleneck for a successful pregnancy. So we have achieved till here. We found a good egg, we found a good sperm, we formed a good embryo. What about implantation? Now this is really the bottleneck for a successful pregnancy. Aim of IVF, of course, is to have a single healthy baby, and whatever we may be doing, we have not really been able to, let us say, completely understand this last part of implantation. It's mainly due to, as I said, absence or suppression of molecules which are required for endometrial receptivity. Of course, gynecological diseases like endometriosis, hydrosalpinx, leiomyoma, endometrial polyps, adenomyosis, PCOS, all these, as I'll talk further, can also hamper implantation. Of course, age we've already talked, and not difficult to understand that if we look at the complete cycles, if the results are as good as around 30% in the younger age group, they drop down to 2-3% in 43 to 44 years, and nearly 1% if it is above 45. So obesity again, you know, you can see that best is when you have a BMI between 20 to 25 and more than 30, the live pregnancy and take-home baby rate drastically reduces. Again, this is not... What about smoking? Now, a very powerful data demonstrating an entirely preventable cause of IVF failure. There are 17 studies which have shown lower pregnancy, lower live birth rate in and more risk of spontaneous miscarriage in women who smoked. So it is important to strongly counsel to cut smoking when they are trying IVF or when they are becoming pregnant. What about fibroids? They have long been known, they are there. It's not difficult to see that a subserosal you may not bother, a submucosal you are sure that it has to be removed. But the results of meta-analysis of 19 studies showing 21% relative reduction in the live birth rate in women with non-cavity distorting. I'm saying non-cavity distorting intramural fibroids compared to women without fibroids. So even when you can see fibroids which are not distorting the cavity yet, they have a deleterious effect on IVF. What about thyroid? Now, patients with anti-thyroid antibodies show significantly lower fertilization rate, lower implantation rate, higher risk for abortion following IVF, ET, or even normal pregnancy. So it is important. Thyroid gland is a very, very important gland as far as pregnancy is concerned and IVF is concerned. What about the embryo? If you were asked to ask me one step in the whole of process, the most important is the embryo transfer technique. It is extremely important to transfer the embryos in the right manner, and on this will depend the experience of the physician. Whether a mock or a trial transfer has been done before to know whether there is going to be any difficulty in transferring the embryo. The technique used, is it just clinical by touch or is it ultrasound guided? The type of catheter use, is it a soft or a rigid catheter? The proper handling, if it is a difficult transfer, how you have handled that transfer, and confirmation of the exact embryo placement in the uterus. Now, if you see the SART guidelines for embryo transfer is the number of embryos to be transferred. In a favorable case, favorable means the first cycle of IVF, a good quality embryo, and if the excess embryos are there, they're available for cryo, you have the facility for cryopreservation. So, or a previous successful, so these are favorable cases. First cycle and a good, you have a good embryo, how many embryos to be transferred? In that, if the age is less than 35, they say one. If you have a cleavage stage embryo, that means day two or day three, and or maybe one or two, but only one in case of a blastocyst transfer. If it is 35 to 37, you can transfer two cleavage stage and again two blastocysts. So blastocysts, if any embryo has reached the day five or a blastocyst stage, you really don't have to transfer too many. Even you can see in this chart, when it is more than 40 years, then the number of blastocysts that one can transfer is three. While in a favorable case or an unfavorable case, the age is a big, big bar. So the SART guidelines say that we can transfer around five embryos in that so to give a good chance of a pregnancy. Of course, Europe has settled to a single embryo transfer and maximum to a double, even the double embryo transfer is now getting reduced to a single embryo transfer, but that is for Europe. Most of the world otherwise following these guidelines, really speaking, say maybe one or two blastocysts can be transferred. Of course, chances of twinning will be much higher. Ultrasound guidance, of course, it should be there because that increases the clinical pregnancy date, and data has been confirmed by the recent Cochrane meta-analysis. What can be the difficulty in the embryo transfer? A stenosis, so you have not really done a mock trial before, and suddenly when you start transferring and you see the cervix is stenosed. Or this acutely antiverted or acutely retroflexed uterus, so the cervico-uterine angle, if you have not really looked at it. A long and tortuous cervix, it could be a cervical fibroid. How to solve the problem? Be prepared, of course, anticipate, and of course, look at the type of catheter that you can use. Coming to the next problem is thrombophilia. So coagulopathy, thrombophilia is a significant role in IVF embryo transfer implantation failure. And they should be screened for thrombophilia. It may play a big role. All hypercoagulable disorders causing vasculopathies can have a big role in this. What about endometrial receptivity? They've just come out that an endometrial biopsy done in the cycle immediately preceding IVF significantly increased the implantation rate, pregnancy and live birth rate in women who had more one or more IVF failure. Now this is a new thing coming out that one should do, one should really handle the endometrium in a cycle before. Could be because of injury induced decidualization or histamine release, whatever may be the reason, but at the moment it is still in the research stage, but this is one new development that is there. I will just talk of the 14 possible approaches to the management of infertile couples with repeated implantation failure. First, I'll just enumerate first, a blastocyst transfer, an assisted hatching, co-culture, doing a pre-genetic screening, hysteroscopy, sildenafil, doing a salpingectomy for hydrosalpings, oocyte donation, transferring more number of embryos, intratubal embryo transfer, natural cycle IVF, antiphospholipid antibody testing, and allogenic lymphocyte therapy. Coming to sildenafil or Viagra, now how does it act? It blocks the breakdown of cyclic GMP and increases the nitric oxide in the environment. The nitric oxide increase causes vasodilatation. However, nitric oxide can also react with the natural killer cells and release tumor necrosis factor alpha, which can again, you know, reject the embryo. So it is important to give sildenafil, but it is used only 5 days prior to the embryo transfer. What about hydrosalpinx? So there are so many cases when you see bilateral blocked tubes and hydrosalpinx. How does it act? It's the chemical in the fluid is hostile to the embryo. There can be a mechanical washout because the fluid itself is not good for it. It also increases the uterine cytokines and the prostaglandin, increasing the uterine contractions and again expelling the embryo. Now, which are the hydrosalpinges which require salpingectomy? It says that large hydrosalpinges which are visible on ultrasound, and if they are bilateral, then they should have a salpingectomy done. What about blastocyst transfer? Of course, we know that day 2, day 3 cleavage embryos, or do you go to day 5, day 6? Day 2, day 3 embryos sequentially are transported from a pyruvate-rich medium to a glucose-rich medium to develop into a blastocyst. But how many embryos will reach that stage? Because not all embryos are healthy enough, so only the healthiest embryo is going to survive. Of course, it is also a good thing is that it's self-selection of the embryo is done, and that is again increasing the endometrial receptivity. But the blastocyst transfer is recommended in young patients and who have multiple oocytes and who have multiple good quality embryos. Because then you know that out of whatever number of embryos you have, few of them will become blastocysts and will be able to get transferred. Otherwise, at the end of the cycle, you may be left with no embryos to transfer. So it's important to counsel the patient when you're taking them for a blastocyst or a day 5-6 transfer. What about assisted hatching? We are assisting hatching. So the blastocyst has to come out of the zona pellucida and hatch and attach to the endometrium. The hardening of the zona pellucida in the IVF culture medium, and it is implicated that the medium itself causes hardening of the zona pellucida and may make it difficult for the embryo to hatch. You can do a mechanical disruption of the zona pellucida by a glass pipette or by a chemical, an acid thyroid medium, or a laser. So any of these can cause, you have to make a small hole in the zona pellucida and let the embryo hatch out. But it is important because the time between the assisted hatching and the embryo transfer, you are exposing the embryo to the foreign elements. So all this has to be taken care of while we are doing an assisted hatching program. Again, the size of the hole is important. If it's too narrow an opening, it may cause trapping. Though it may not, you know, trying to come out may not, and may double up and cause monozygote. It's known monozygotic twinning is more common in such embryos. If the hole becomes too large, then there may be premature hatching. So the right amount of laser applied to form a hole, which is just enough for the embryo to hatch, is very important. Now, a meta-analysis by Safe et al. Showed that it has higher pregnancy rate but not increased live birth rate, while a meta-analysis by Salam showed that it hatching produced higher implantation, pregnancy, and ongoing pregnancy rate. So we are still, you know, whether it really, although assisted hatching has now evidence-based says that it has a role in helping good implantation. What about co-culture? Now, it is very well known that the embryo and the endometrium talk to each other, what we call a crosstalk. Now that crosstalk we can start at the fertilization stage itself by taking the endometrial and the granular cells and culturing them with the embryo in the medium itself. This crosstalk increases some, causes some kind of paracrine release, which helps in the implantation. It also removes the toxic substances, the heavy metals, ammonium, and free radicals from the medium, and it improves the in vitro parameters. Again, co-culture is still under research, and it came up in a big way, still under research whether it is going to be. So many of the times we are not denuding the cells and letting the glandular cells remain so that the crosstalk can start there. What about pre-implantation genetic screening? Now, it is a very well-known fact that chromosomal abnormality causes spontaneous abortion in 60% of the general population as it is. We all know that if a patient aborts, 60% of them will have one or the other chromosomal abnormality. And aneuploidy is 54 to 57% compared to 35% in control group in multiple implants. So if you see a multiple implantation failure, you'll see aneuploidy is much more common there. 27% of the clinical pregnancy rate for patients in recurrent implantation failure, better than 18% in the control group when pre-implantation genetic screening was done. So how do we do a pre-implantation genetic screening? The embryo is there. We have developed it to day 2, day 3. It's an 8-cell stage and one cell is taken out. And that cell will have the full chromosomal complement. It can be tested, and my colleague will also enlighten on how the tests are done, what tests are done. And then one can rule out and see which are the embryos which are unaffected. Because morphologically, if you look at the embryos, they all look same. But the tests will show that most of them may not be normal, and that is why implantation may be failing. So if you can select the best embryos which are euploid, then that makes implantation successful. To have 90% probability of having an embryo transfer after PGS, patients should have at least 10 mature oocytes, 8 fertile, at least 8 of them should get fertilized, and at least you should have 6 embryos for biopsy on day 3, because one should have enough embryos to decide on between and not waste a full cycle on it. What about hysteroscopy? When we do an ultrasound, you will find that 22% of the population with a normal looking ultrasound, and if you go for a hysteroscopy, you will see that there are endometrial polyps, endometrial adhesions, endocervical adhesions, endometritis, uterine septae, and submucous fibroids, which were not visible on ultrasound. So hysteroscopy has a big role, especially in repeated implantation failures, to go inside, look and see whether any of the treatable causes are there, which could be treated before taking the patient for another cycle. Well, there is gene polymorphism and for digestion of endometrium, and genes required for implantation, as I said, you require some suppressor genes, P53 codon 7 tumor suppressor factor. You require an enzyme for digesting the endometrium, plasminogen activator inhibitor, and a vascular endothelial growth factor. So you require all these for the alloantigen to be recognized and accepted in the body. What about oocyte donation? So whenever you have a woman who's more than 40 and you can see the antral follicle count is less and the AMH is low, and she's already tried, repeated implantation failures are there, it makes sense in trying to replace the egg and take and counsel her for oocyte donation. As you know, in India, oocyte donation is anonymous, so you have to have an anonymous donor. She's pre-screened for most infections, and your routine testing of diabetes, thyroid, thalassemia, then all your infections, VDRL, HIV, HBS, antigen, HCV, all that are done. She's screened well, and then usually it is between the girl or the woman is more than 21 years of age, and she is accepted as an oocyte donor. And one should suggest that, especially there are people who come at 42, 43. At that age, the antral follicle count is really low. So it is important, instead of trying again and again with her cycles, to suggest oocyte donation. Okay, now this is again the number of embryos to be transferred. Now, what about intratubal embryo transfer? This again is a laparoscopic procedure. It is important to know that the fertilization occurs in the tube and the embryo stays in the tube for 2 to 3 days and only then comes into the uterus. So if we do an intratubal embryo transfer, the natural growth milieu of the tube and the growth factors, the cytokines from the tubal fluid, will help increase in the synchronization and increase the implantation potential. day one or day two embryos. It's important not to put them directly into the uterus. They belong to the tube. So people have tried intratubal embryo transfer but have not caught on because it's a laparoscopic procedure and meta-analysis really failed to demonstrate any big advantage of this procedure. What about lymphocyte immunotherapy? Now, as we said, paternal HLA recognized by the maternal immune system produces alloantibodies. And anti-paternal cytotoxic antibodies, anti-idiotypic antibodies, mixed lymphocyte reaction blocking antibodies, they all coat the trophoblast, making it undetectable. So it is important that the paternal character of the embryo is suppressed in some way for the maternal not to recognize and accept the embryo inside its endometrium. Lymphocyte immunotherapy, again, evidence-based does not support, although there are many centers which are giving this therapy, injecting the paternal serum into the mother, developing antibodies so that it is not rejected, but evidence has not supported this therapy. Well, embryo is a semi-allogen and it is very, very important that the cytoimmunity, the T helper 2 and T helper 1 cells. Now let us look at the normal invasion. What happens when an embryo is there? The paternal antigen, acts on the T cell immunity, and there are both T helper 1 and T helper 2 cells. Now it is the T helper 2 cells which will release interleukin 4, 10, and help in the acceptance of the embryo, while the T helper 1 cells, you know, have to be suppressed, which happens with these interleukins, and there are no NK cells, no cytotoxic T cells, and the embryo is, this is what happens in the normal invasion. But what about in failed invasion? The paternal antigen is again, you know, the T helper 1 cells are activated, and new natural killer cells, cytotoxic T cells, all of them have a mount a cell-mediated immunity which does not really accept the embryo, and the embryo is rejected. So the ratio of T helper 1 and T helper 2 cells are very important to see when we are looking at implantation. Well, that was as far as medical was concerned, but I'm sure the patient will come and say, "Doctor, why did my cycle fail?" IVF failure causes a lot of distress, both for the patient and for the doctor. There are lots of questions and, really speaking, no clear answers. Patients blame themselves sometimes. Did the cycle fail because I did something wrong? Did I exercise? Did I not eat proper? Was I too stressed? Is my body rejecting the embryo? Please do not shun your patient after an IVF failure because patients are very vulnerable. They can be angry with the doctor. They can blame you for the failure. Doctors do not want to talk to patients when the cycle fails. Please do not abandon. They need you most at this time. It's important to analyze what went right, what went wrong, and what have we learned. Do we need to change anything the next time? And what should we change? So where was the fault? Was it in the sperm, in the egg, or in the implantation? It's important. Did you form good embryos? Was the superovulation protocol good enough? Did it have enough number of eggs for you to work on? Was the endometrial thickness and texture good enough for the embryo to be accepted? Did the embryo transfer? Did it pose any technical difficulty? In the lab, look at whether the fertilization rate was good enough. How was the embryo quality? And how did other patients on the same day do? So was the sterilization of the lab? What about the medium that you are using? So you all have to look at each parameter has to be scrutinized again and again to make out why the IVF cycle failed. Well, the only good embryo is the one which becomes a baby. There's no other thing that we can. We can grade the embryos, but we still cannot predict which embryo will really become a baby. Of course, blastocysts, these are the things that we can do. Blastocyst culture, laser hatching, co-culture. The newer tools, the embryos are secreting metabolites, so metabolomics and proteins. Proteomics are now into the research stage. Maybe in the newer times, we will be able to look at that. What about PGD? Of course, array CGH, better genetic technology. So the role of PGS and PGD is now coming up in a big way. Will that be able to decide the best quality embryos to be put in? That's what we have to see. Please give photos to the embryos or photos of the embryos to the patients. The patient knows what kind of embryos were put in. Every patient should be there. Documentary evidence of the quality of treatment received should be there. And what can we change? Well, we can change everything. We can change the eggs. If the eggs are not good, oocyte donor. We can change the sperms. If you find that there are diseases which require changing, or the sperm parameters, you've tried a few cycles and you think it's not working, you can change the uterus. So surrogacy is in a big, big way. The results are as good as 80-85%, because if you have a good embryo and you have a tuberculous endometritis, or you have Asherman, or you have whatever cause which has destroyed the endometrium, why not change the uterus? Go in for surrogacy. Or, of course, you can change the clinic, because if one clinic has not worked, maybe something not good enough. So you can change everything from one to all. What is important is you need to counsel and educate your patients prior to start of the IVF cycle. Prepare for plan B. If this doesn't work, what next? IVF can be a roller coaster ride. Patients need to have realistic expectations, and this will help the patient cope better with failure when it occurs. You tell them that from, depending on her age, from 35 to maximum to 45 to 50% is the success rate in the best of the centers. So there are chances of her failing, and her to be well prepared to accept failure. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rita, for enlightening us on this topic. We have few questions, the online questions. Dr. Renu Gupta from Panipat is asking, males having oligospermia with normal semen counts on and off without varicocele, what is the possible cause and how to treat it and the infertility?
Right. So when you are seeing an oligospermic sample, as I was just saying, semen count and WHO parameters have also changed now. We just say it is 15 million per ml. That is the count if it is there. You know, previously it was 20, 30, 40 million. Now we know if it is 15 million per ml, it is good enough. Also, the progressive motility. The WHO parameters again say 32% progressively motile sperm, good enough. Morphology has taken a big, big change, you know. It is now only 4% morphologically normal sperms are good. So what we are calling oligospermia is also very important. And if the patient is oligospermic, then, you know, one really has to look for, first and foremost, is infections. So you have to, a good prostatic massage has to be done. And prostate, the secretions have to be really tested, whether there any infection is there or not. After doing the routine infection, and if you've seen, then of course all the minerals that are available in the market today, that including coenzyme Q10. So what I do is I give an empirical antibiotic course to such patients, even if the culture sometimes comes negative, followed that by giving these minerals. So coenzyme Q10 has a big role in increasing the count and the motility. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Dr. Menka is asking about the difference between minor and major cytogenetic responses.
I think my next speaker will be better able to answer that. He's from Lal PathLabs and talking on cytogenetics.
Dr. R.K. Chitlangia and Dr. Sharmila are asking, how healthy is the IVF baby? And Dr. Sharmila is asking, if we are using the frozen eggs, what is the, like, the health of the IVF baby in particular?
Very nice. So IVF babies are as healthy as any other babies. I will not say that the congenital abnormality rate is just a wee bit higher. So it is, you know, it's 0.1% that is slightly higher than normal. But if you ask me, more or less, they are, IVF babies are as healthy. And frozen oocytes are still in the research method, but are giving equally good results. So there are a lot of people, we are not encouraging freezing oocytes for social reasons, but I have come across many cases, especially when going for chemotherapy, coming up for cryopreservation of eggs. And this will become a big modality, I think, in the times to come. With soaring careers, it's more and more women are coming up. I had the other day a woman at 42 from USA coming up of not having still found the right partner, and she wanted to freeze her eggs.
Yeah, the same question is from Neetu Bala. She's from Gurgaon. She's asking, I'm 40 years old woman. will IVF work for me?
Well, I will not say that it will not work for her, because it will all depend on her AMH and her ovarian reserve. Definitely the success rate is lower, as I said. I mean, there are no two points on it. But whenever realize, I think one should try as soon as possible. Exactly. And not wait too long. If it doesn't work, I think one should be very flexible in mind to accept the changes that can happen.
Exactly, the donations.
The donations. So it is really important. I think the first thing that we counsel is, in case, because you have to have another plan in place.
Exactly. Dr. Jyotsna from City Hospital is asking, what is the procedure for egg retrieval, complications in IVF cycle?
Now, egg retrieval is done under general anesthesia. Normally, there are two types of cycles that we do, an agonist or an antagonist cycle. So either the woman is called a week before her menses, or she's called on the first or second day of her menses, and the stimulation is done. She is stimulated for about 10 to 12 days, and when you look at the eggs and the estradiol levels, and the eggs are mature enough, then you give an HCG injection, and exactly from 34 to 36 hours after giving the injection, she's taken to the OT, and anesthesia is given, and a needle is introduced through the vagina with an ultrasound probe going into each follicle in the ovary through the vagina. So it's not a procedure in which any operation per se is there. All the eggs or all the follicles are aspirated, so they come out in a test tube, and that's why it's called a test tube baby. So all the eggs are aspirated and given to the embryologist to look at the quality of eggs and fertilize them. So the complications that can occur are hyperstimulation, because if you are stimulating the ovaries, especially in a PCO case where there are too many, if you look at it's more than 20 and you trying to stimulate that ovary, she can undergo hyperstimulation, and hyperstimulation means fluid in the abdomen, so ascites, pericardial, pleural, everywhere the fluid can be there. So it is important to be very, very careful about hyperstimulation when we are stimulating a patient. Also, the complications of surgery. So one can, if not done properly, can enter into a vessel, and that can cause problems.
Yeah, the same question has been asked by Dr. Amy Azhar from Delhi. He is asking, how are the drugs affecting the hyperstimulation, ovarian hyperstimulation syndromes, which are being used for the stimulation of ovaries during IVF?
So it is very, very important, as I said, that hyperstimulation is one complication which you can get no pregnancy, no problem. But no hyperstimulation is very, very important, because this is life-threatening. And so it is really important that to stimulate with a smaller dose, go in a very sequential, small step-up regime, and stop. What we can do to prevent hyperstimulation is take out all the eggs and freeze. Take out all the eggs, fertilize, freeze the embryo. Do not transfer. One thing. Mm-hmm. Other is take out all the. It's very, very important to wash each follicle. So there are some people who will put a double lumen catheter and will try to flush each egg after. So every single egg has been taken out. That's one. Only after giving an HCG injection will hyperstimulation occur. So one is to abandon the cycle completely. Not to do that cycle. Cycle goes waste, but then life is there. Or if you still want to go ahead, at least don't transfer the embryos. That's another thing. So freeze all the embryos.
Fine. Dr. Sharmila is asking another question. What is the link between ovarian cysts and fertility?
It will depend on what kind of cysts which are there. It is very normal on any of the stimulating drugs to have cysts. Cyst is basically an egg which is not ruptured. It could be a corpus luteal cyst. It could be a complicated cyst or a solid cyst, could be a dermoid cyst, or it could be a CA. So it'll all depend on what kind of cyst we are looking at. So most of the cysts, if they are less than 3 to 5 centimeters, really you can just ignore them, not do anything. What you can do is suppress the cyst by giving her an oral contraceptive pill following that, and hope that the cyst will suppress. Most of the cysts do suppress on oral contraceptives.
That's all, Dr. Rita.
Thank you.
We will be, from the live audience, we'll be doing after this session, after the second session.
Thank you.
Thank you. After an years of IVF, we would further proceed to the diagnostic perspective of IVF. We would now hear Dr. Saurabh on the cytogenetic approaches for OBS and gynaecs related disorders and IVF. He would enrich our knowledge on the need of cytogenetic examination, the chromosomal aberrations, the methodology involved in cytogenetics, and various tests being performed in Dr. Lal PathLabs. Dr. Saurabh is a hardcore cytogenetics from CMC Vellore, and after completing his education, has been a tutor himself at CMC Vellore. He joined our organization in 2013 as Deputy HOD and has done a tremendous work in cytogenetics. Welcome, Dr. Saurabh.
Hello. Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for the nice introduction, Dr. Ratima. And it was a really mind-boggling speech by Dr. Rita, because even I have educated myself now, so I can understand that how much it is a need of a society to get a good embryo for in vitro fertilization. And I'll be covering the cytogenetics part, because I am a cytogeneticist, so I'll be covering how we can help IVF specialist or embryologist to decide how to go further for the procedure. And okay, just to give a small introduction about cytogenetics, what we do in Dr. Lal PathLab, we are the first private lab in North India to start cytogenetics effectively. And we have more than 15 years of experience in our, the staff who are working in our laboratory has more than 10 to 12 years of experience, few are 15 years of experience. And first lab in the country to have maximum number of tests offered, and we are NABL, CAP, and ISO accredited. Then who needs cytogenetic study? This is just a basic question coming to mind, that cytogenetic tests are so specialized tests that we cannot just offer anybody, whoever is coming to the doctor. So who needs cytogenetic study? First thing, clinical cytogenetics, determination of karyotype of patients with inborn defects. So babies who are born with the inborn defects have some dysmorphic features, have some developmental delay, they can be offered as a cytogenetic test. Second is prenatal cytogenetics, where examination of chromosomal complement of embryos or in vitro fertilization, that's what I'm going to cover here. And then last is oncocytogenetics, specification of diagnosis and prognosis of malignant diseases. So what are chromosomal aberrations? Chromosomal aberrations are, first thing, changes of numbers or structure of chromosome. So we know that we have total of 46 number of chromosome, 23 haploid cells, and 23 from mother, 23 from father, and we have total of 46 number of chromosome. If that number going up, then it can be aneuploid. It can go down. Suppose 45, 44 number, that is also aneuploid. So changes in the actual number in the of the chromosomes can lead to aneuploidy. And then structural chromosomal aberrations, I'll be just giving you a brief about structural chromosomal aberrations, like translocations, deletions, inversions, like that lots of structural aberrations are present. So if you divide these aberrations in a broad way, the first will be inborn aberrations, where babies are born with the inborn errors or cytogenetical abnormalities. So inborn aberrations are fundamental for origin of syndromes due to anomalies of chromosomes. Example, Down syndrome, where the Down syndrome baby has three copies of chromosome number 21, or it is called as trisomy 21, where changes of chromosomes are present in all cells of the body, or if they are mosaic, then few cells will be a normal. So severity depends on the mosaic types of cells present in the body. Next is acquired abnormalities, what patients have acquired later on in their age, like cancers or leukemias, that also can be associated with chromosomal aberrations. So what are all methods are available in cytogenetics? What we do in our laboratory, first thing is basic conventional cytogenetic analysis, where we band the chromosomes. Banding in the sense, we just digest the proteins present in the chromosome, which is called as with the help of proteolytic enzyme, and the enzyme name is trypsin. So we band the chromosomes, and then it is very easy for us to identify the chromosomes according to the banding pattern. Second is interface fish. Interface fish means we just take the interface cells from the patients, we just extract the interface cells, and then we put a probe, fish probe, and then see the signals. So this is very fast and very good technique being used in our laboratory. Next is WCP fish, means whole chromosome paint fish. So we, in this technique, we paint a particular chromosome in one color, and then if there is a balanced translocation or if there is a shift of any part of the chromosome in another chromosome, it can be detected through this technique, which is called as WCP FISH. Third is M-FISH. In M-FISH, we color all the chromosomes in different colors. So suppose chromosome 1 is painted in green color, chromosome 2 in red color, and then yellow, and lots of other colors, we can paint the chromosomes in different color. So this is called as multicolor FISH. Then next is multicolor banding also. Here, in different part of the chromosomes can be colored in a different colors. So this is very sophisticated and very difficult technique actually, but it is in very high demand in research. In diagnostic, if it is asked by the clinician, then we are doing this. But this is little bit costly than other techniques. Then at last, comparative genomic hybridization, which is very reliable and very effective technique used in diagnostic nowadays. But there are certain limitations of this test also, because in this technique, we can detect microdeletion, duplications. Duplication means copy of the particular genes. Deletion means a deletion of the particular genes. So this can be detected through this comparative genomic hybridization, but balanced translocations or inversions cannot be detected through this technique. So there are certain limitations. I just give you a brief about what is conventional cytogenetic analysis. The conventional cytogenetic analysis, we know that we have to extract metaphase chromosome, because metaphase is the only stage where chromosomes are in a good shape, good length, and then we can detect the abnormalities very efficiently in metaphase stage. So if you see the first part of the first portion of the pictures, this is a cycle where we have to take out the metaphase chromosome and then we have to karyotype it. So karyotyping is nothing but an arrangement of the chromosome according to their banding pattern and the size of the chromosome. So after we karyotype, we know that the chromosome numbers are more than 46 or less than 46, and if there is any structural aberrations like translocations or deletion or inversion is present or not. And according to the ISCN, International System for Cytogenetic Nomenclature, this is a committee who is deciding that how we have to report the cases. So ISCN is very important for any cytogenetist to report the cases. So we use this ISCN 2013. This is the latest 2013 edition of ISCN. And overall procedure contains, when we get a blood sample or when we get a bone marrow sample, when we get a tissue, anything, we can extract the chromosome through this broad procedure. Here we have to take the, suppose this is an example where we have taken 5 ml venous blood. We add some chemicals like phytohemagglutinin, and then culture mediums are there. And this is the sterile flask where we incubate it for 2 to 3 days in 37 degree centigrade. And then we add, after this 2 to 3 days, we add colchicine. Colchicine or colchicine is a chemical which arrests the chromosomes in a metaphase stage, and then it is ready to make a slide, and then in the slide we see the chromosomes, and finally we do the karyotype. So this is just a broad scheme how we are going for karyotyping. And in traditional microscopy, what we see, when we go for 100x magnification, we see this type of patches in the slide. That means the metaphase index is good, and then we go for 1000x oil magnification, and then we can see the chromosomes like this. And then we have to recognize the abnormality, we have to karyotype it, and then finally we can report the cases. So the software which is used to karyotype is what we are using in our laboratory is a CytoVision software given by the Leica company. From Applied Biosystems. So this software looks like this. So this is just a screenshot of the software. And this software is very helpful to analyze the chromosome, to arrange the chromosome in a proper way. But just note down that cytogenetic analysis or karyotype needs lots of expertise. All the software is available, but it is very difficult to identify. If you do not have cytogenetic experience, you cannot identify the chromosomes. You cannot even identify the abnormalities present in the chromosome. So that needs lots of expertise. And if you see common chromosomal abnormalities, I was talking about deletion, translocations, and other things. So first thing is translocation. Translocation means if any chromosome is giving or exchanging their genetic material to other chromosome and taking it back. So that is a balanced translocation. Means I have given you something, you have given me something. That is balanced translocation. If I have given you something, you have not given me back. So that is unbalanced translocation. Okay. Second is deletion. Deletion means part of the chromosome or part of the gene has gone out. We don't know where. and it is maybe it is inherited and maybe it is acquired. Acquired in the sense in leukemias we can see some kind of deletions. So deletion is more fatal and more dangerous than translocation, because in translocation genetic material is maintained in the cells, although it has gone here and there, but it is maintained in the cells. But in deletion it is difficult, because deletion that means loss of the genes, loss of the genetic materials, which is more fatal. And then we have inversion. Inversion means there is a break happened, there is a break up and down in a particular chromosome, and then it got inverted. So inversion can be of two types. It can be paracentric, it can be pericentric. These are just terminology. I'm just giving you a brief terminology, pericentric and paracentric. Pericentric means including centromere if there is an inversion. If there is no no involvement of the centromere, that is paracentric inversion. Centromere means where the chromosomes are divided in two arms. So the center part of the chromosome is called as centromere. Then we have isochromosome. Isochromosome means when two chromosomes get broken in the centromere part and they join with each other and they form a chromosome called as isochromosome. Means both the arms are now equal of different chromosomes. Then we have insertion. Insertion is kind of translocation also, you can say, but not exactly translocation. Insertion means one chromosome has given its part and it has got inserted into the particular other chromosome. So that is insertion. Means genetic material is maintained in the cells, there is no loss of the genetic material, still deletion is more fatal. We have ring chromosome. This is particularly seen in the cancers or leukemias where both the terminal ends of the chromosomes got deleted and they joined and form a structure called as ring chromosome. And at last, derivative chromosome. Derivative chromosome is very difficult to find out, because if there is a more than one or two aberrations have happened in particular chromosome, then we call it as derivative chromosome. So this is just a brief of how we detect the chromosomal abnormalities. Now, who needs cytogenetic study? First, as I'm going to talk about in this, pre-implantation genetic diagnosis, where we have to decide whether the egg or sperm what we are taking for the fertilization is good or not, having any genetic abnormality or not. Second, prenatal diagnosis means after fertilization, then prenatal diagnosis can be done, where we can, if ultrasonography findings are abnormal, then we can detect the abnormalities through prenatal diagnosis in particular stages. I'll be talking about that later. And then postnatal diagnosis means after birth, if there is any abnormality, we can detect chromosomal abnormalities and we can say whether, and we can counsel the patients also, and we can counsel the parents that your baby has this particular problem, and then you have to go accordingly. Then we have recurrent pregnancy losses if couples are not at all conceiving, and if there is a recurrent losses of the pregnancies, and if there is a recurrent abortions, then we can check the chromosomes, and if there is a balanced translocation present in either of the couples, then it can be a possible cause of recurrent abortions or recurrent pregnancy losses. And then babies with dysmorphism or developmental delay. Dysmorphism means facial dysmorphism. If there is a cleft palate or cleft lip or ear, low set ears, and anything polydactyly or syndactyly or any kind of abnormality. Other than that, developmental delay, if baby is not achieving the milestones, whether the baby doesn't start walking in at a particular stage, it doesn't start speaking, and then there could be a possible micro deletions present on their chromosomes that can be detected through chromosomal detection. Then if anybody has, suppose if any lady or any particular male is going to get married, and if they have parental history of chromosomal aberrations or abnormalities, then they should go for cytogenetic analysis, so that particular aberration or abnormality has not been inherited to them, so that can be ruled out before marriage. And then at last, of course, hematological malignancies or tumorigenesis. So I'll be covering today these two particular part, pre-implantation genetic diagnosis and prenatal diagnosis. And then question comes, why cytogenetic study is important? We know that chromosome disorders form a major category of genetic diseases. Second, cytogenetic testing helps with decision about treatment and to monitor disease status and recovery. Suppose in leukemia, if we know that the particular patient has CML and 922 translocation, and after therapy, what is the condition, whether it is relapsing or whether it is still there, that can be ruled out. And third is, cytogenetic study helps to decide future pregnancy also. So what and all tests we do at Dr. Lal Path Labs here, first is prenatal diagnosis by FISH, prenatal diagnosis by karyotyping, postnatal diagnosis, chromosome study in blood, chromosome study in bone marrow, stress cytogenetics. This is chromosome breakage syndrome where before bone marrow transplantation, if patient can be ruled out by Fanconi's anemia or something, that can be ruled out through this test, stress cytogenetics. And at last, FISH analysis in blood, bone marrow, or any other tissue we want to check. So I'll be covering this first part now, pre-implantation genetic diagnosis. What is pre-implantation genetic diagnosis? As ma'am has told very beautifully, I'm just going to give you a definition. Genetic analysis of a single cell from a 8-cell embryo done in conjunction with in vitro fertilization to improve the chances of a normal pregnancy. So that is pre-implantation genetic diagnosis. Why consider pre-implantation genetic diagnosis in addition to IVF? First, if recurrent miscarriages are happening, one child already affected with the genetic diseases, then they should go for PGD. Family history of any inherited diseases present. Maternal age older than 38 years, ma'am has told 35 years, so the 35 to 38 years can be considered as a minimum age. And then prior to IVF failures, so if there is a continuous IVF failures are happening, then they should go for PGD analysis. And then family balancing for sex. So what and all methods can be done in PGD as far as our cytogenetics is concerned? First, remove a single cell from the 6 to 8 cell embryo using a fine glass needle to puncture the zona pellucida and aspirate the cells. So in skilled hands, this generally does not harm the developing embryo. And each cell is called as a blastomere. Then we can prepare a metaphase spread of chromosomes to assess karyotype, or we can do a FISH. So two types of assessment techniques are very commonly used in cytogenetics. First is chromosome painting. As I told, that whole chromosome paint we can use and we can find out balanced translocation. So chromosome painting using fluorescent probes specific for each chromosome. These allow number and size of each chromosome to be checked. So useful for identifying aneuploidies. Aneuploidies, if there is a loss of chromosome, if there is a gain of chromosome, that we can detect through this technique. And if there is a procedure that destroys the tested cells. So this is the technique in which the tested cells can be destroyed. So this is one of the drawback of this type of FISH analysis. And limited number of chromosomes can be checked simultaneously. This is one good thing that we can check even other chromosomes, whether they are involved in the particular translocations or not. And then second part of this assessment is polymerase chain reaction, where we can detect single gene disorders. So this is just an example of chromosome painting we can do. You can see this is chromosome number 1, which is painted in a pink color. And if there is an involvement of any balanced translocation, this pink color can be seen in other chromosome that can be detected. And we have a panel for screening aneuploids. Aneuploids means we have a set of few chromosomes where if doctors are asking, okay, we have to check 5 chromosomes for this aneuploidy, or we have to check 10 chromosomes, that panels we have. So this 5 chromosome of PGD includes chromosome 13, 18, 21, X and Y. So why this only this chromosome? Because chromosome 13 involves for Patau syndrome, trisomy 13, 18 for Edward syndrome, 21 for Down syndrome, and X and Y for Turner or Klinefelter or any sexual abnormality we can detect through this panel. Apart from this, we have a 10 chromosomes prenatal genetic diagnosis, pre-implantation genetic diagnosis, where we have chromosome 8, chromosome 9, 13, 15, 16, 18, 21, 22, X and Y. So this all includes a major type of syndromes which can be detected through this panel. So this is just an example of 5 chromosome PGD. First panel of the picture shows normal female where you have 2 XX, you can see a pink color XX, and then 2 copies of chromosome 13, 2 copies of chromosome 18, and 2 copies of chromosome 21. That means it is a normal female. Then if it is a normal male, then we have 1 X and Y. So 1 X, 1 Y shows a male, XX is female. So 10 chromosome PGD shows 10 different types of chromosome together in one cell. We have a chromosome 9, 16, 22, 15, 8 and other chromosomes. So simultaneously we can see all the test chromosomes what we have added in this particular test and in one cell itself. So if you compare prenatal diagnosis with pre-implantation genetic diagnosis, what and all differences we can see? So in prenatal diagnosis, we need at least more than 1 lakh cells. But in PGD, we have, if we have one cell also, we can detect the abnormality. The time taken by prenatal diagnosis is minimum 2 weeks because it needs lots of culture things. We have to put the culture and then we have to see whether cells are growing or not. So it takes 2 weeks. But in PGD, we can check the abnormality within 6 to 10 hours or less than that also depends on how we are starting the procedure. Accuracy, the accuracy is 99% in both of them. But there is a limitation of PGD where what and all probes what we are using for this 5 panel or 10 panels, in conjunction to that chromosomes only we can detect the abnormality. But in prenatal diagnosis, we can detect all the 46 chromosomes together. So prenatal diagnosis, culture is still a gold standard, but PGD is in vitro fertilizations and other things is very useful. So what and all advantages and disadvantages, as I have discussed, I just give you a brief of advantages. First, avoid pregnancy termination. Avoid procedure related to pregnancy losses and improve ongoing pregnancy rates also. What and all disadvantages? They have to undergo in vitro fertilization. It is relatively expensive because probes are already very expensive, but in culture it is less expensive. Can only be done for anomalies associated with cytogenetic or single gene disorders. So we can detect only cytogenetic abnormalities or if any gene is abnormal in that particular egg or not. But other than that, like hormonals or proteomics or metabolomics, if any other problem is there, that cannot be detected through this technique. Now coming to the sperm assays, because this is very important part where the sperm what is used for the in vitro fertilization should be of good quality. So what and all tests we can do for this? First, the technique given by Robeck et al. In 1990. So here we have, you can see here FITC is a filter which is green color, then Rhodamine is a red, then FITC plus Rhodamine shows a yellow color and then Aqua is a blue color. So this type, particular types of filters are available in the microscope which can help to detect the signal pattern of the chromosomes. So in sex chromosome, we can detect Klinefelter syndrome, we can detect trisomy X syndrome, we can detect XYY, that is super male, then we can detect Turner syndrome where only one X chromosome is present, no other X, no other Y. And then if there is a early losses, then maybe chromosome 8 is involved. If there is a spontaneous abortion, then chromosome 16 may be involved. If there is a Patau syndrome, chromosome 13, Edwards syndrome, chromosome 18, and if it is a Down syndrome, chromosome 21. So In our own lab, what we have seen is maximum we have seen Turner syndrome and then Down syndrome, because this is very commonly seen in our Indian population. 4 chromosome fish for detecting aneuploid human sperms. Now, we can directly see the sperms in our fish technique. We can take the sperms, we can make a smear and then we can add a probe. So that probe can be of these 3 types, midi for terminal end of the chromosome. You can see a green color. Midi, then alpha is called as a centromere, the center part of the chromosome, and then classical, any part of the chromosome can be detected. So if you see the first, the B panel of the picture, you have a normal upper end of the panel has a normal sperm where all the colors are present, means ACM, all the 3 colors are present. If there is an aneuploidy, means extra copies are present, we can see 2 type of signals here. This is called as aneuploid. If there is a ACM, means these 3 colors are seen separately, we can detect. If there is a blue color duplication, means extra copy of the blue color is present, that also we can detect. So in this way, we can say that the sperm which is used for in vitro fertilization is good quality or not. That can be done. Now, what and all specialized abnormal sperm assays are available in our laboratory. We can do lots of DNA fragmentation assays and then whether the sperm has a good quality of DNA or not. So this can be broadly classified into 3 parts which can be done. First is acridine orange. Acridine orange is a DNA stain which can be seen in a fluorescent microscope. So we stain the whole chromosome in a whole sperm in a acridine orange stain and then we can see in a fluorescent microscope whether it is showing any DNA fragmentation or not. Then we have a toluene blue. This is done in a light microscopy. We can simply stain in a slide, we can make a smear and we can stain through a toluene blue stain, and then we can see in a light microscope. Third is aniline blue. Aniline is also a DNA stain which can be done in a light microscope. And then the major part is tunnel assay. This tunnel assay is terminal deoxynucleotidyl transferase mediated deoxyuridine triphosphate NIC ending labeling assay. It's a quite a big name. So commonly called as a tunnel assay. So tunnel assay is nothing but a tunnel is an antibody which can be used for detecting the DNA damage in the sperm. So you see blue sperms are tunnel negative while green sperms are tunnel positive, indicating DNA fragmentation. So if so we have to count, suppose we are counting 500 sperms, and in that how many sperms are showing a green color, how many sperms are showing a blue color, that we can take out, and then percentage can be seen in a cutoff way, and then we can say whether the DNA fragmentation is higher in this particular sample or not. Now coming to the next part, why chromosome microdeletion? Suppose sperm is showing a good quality, everything is fine, no problem, ovum is fine, everything is fine. But if there is a deletion, microdeletion present in the Y chromosome, then that sperm is not of any use. So that can be done in our laboratory also. So we have the human Y chromosome plays an essential role in the genetic regulation of spermatogenesis. If there is a microdeletion, there will not be any spermatogenesis. Most of the genes involved in spermatogenesis have been mapped to the proximal long arm of the Y chromosome. Long arm means the lower part of the chromosome may carry lots of important genes like AZF. AZF can be divided into three parts, AZF-A, AZF-B, and AZF-C. So if you see the diagram of the Y chromosome, the upper part, this center part is called as centromere, which is center part of the chromosome Y, and upper part carries SRY gene. SRY gene is deciding the male factor. If SRY gene is absent, then you cannot say that particular patient, particular person has a male characters. So if SRY gene is present, that means we are male. And then the Q arm, that means the lower part of the chromosome contains these three important genes, AZF-A, AZF-B, and AZF-C. Any mutation in this particular genes, in particular subtype of these genes, can lead to a spermatogenesis failure or IVF failure ultimately. So what are the facts for Y chromosome? There is currently no treatment to improve spermatogenesis in patients with Y chromosome microdeletion. However, these patients are candidates for IVF or intracytoplasmic sperm injection. Sperm from semen may be used in oligospermic patients, whereas attempts at testicular sperm extraction may be employed in azoospermic patients. It is important to realize that these deletions may be transmitted to male offspring also. So it is very important if we can detect the SRY gene or this particular gene's deletions. So we know that there is a deletion present in the father, so it may have come to the offspring also. That can be also ruled out in early stages. Couples in whom the husband has Y chromosome microdeletion should be offered genetic counseling before embarking on a course of assisted reproductive techniques. What and all methodology we can do? Y chromosome microdeletion PCR detects the following 27 STS markers, short tandem sequences, AZF-A, AZF-B, and AZF-C. So these are the huge number of markers which can be detected. And if any marker shows any particular deletion, then we can say whether there is a particular deletion present in this patient or not. So what can we interpret? Presence of amplimer for all the STS markers indicates a negative result. So if all the markers are present, we know that the patient is okay, no problem in the Y chromosome. Absence of amplified product for one or more STS markers indicates presence of Y chromosome microdeletion. So any of the marker is not present in our PCR study, then we say that there is a deletion, possible deletion of the Y chromosome in that particular gene. So what and all clinical relevance can be achieved after we check all these things? Presence of Y chromosome microdeletion may help the clinician in evaluating men with azoospermia. So AZF comes from azoospermia. So whether patient is not showing any sperm, that the microdeletion could be the possible cause for this particular thing. Severe oligozoospermia or otherwise unexplained male factor infertility. Microdeletion of either the entire AZF-A or AZF-B regions of the Y chromosome heralds an exceptionally poor prognosis for sperm retrieval. So whereas the majority of the men with AZFC deletion have sperm retrieved successfully for use in IVF with ICSI. So there are certain exceptions also. AZFC deletion people have shown a successful IVF also. So we cannot say, but majorly AZFA and AZFB are the important genes if there is a micro deletion. So there is no successful IVF seen in those patients. Screening for Y chromosome deletions would be indicated in patients undergoing the ICSI and testicular sperm extraction program and prevent the risk of transmitting Y chromosomes micro deletion to the offspring. Now coming to the second part of my talk, prenatal diagnosis, what can be done? This is just a diagrammatic representation of the embryo development from starting from the first day to first week to 40 weeks of gestational age. First part is pre-implantation genetic diagnosis. So even before IVF, we can go for this pre-implantation genetic diagnosis. I have already explained that. Now coming to the third part, means other three parts of the prenatal diagnosis are, first is chorionic villus sampling, where in 10 to 12 weeks of gestation, we can take out the placental cells from the mother and then we can detect the chromosomal abnormality that can be cultured in our laboratory and we can find out the chromosomal abnormalities. Second is amniocentesis, where amniotic fluid can be taken out from particular expert gynecologist, and then that amniotic fluid can be cultured, amniocytes can be cultured from that, and we can achieve the chromosomal pattern, and then we can say whether it is a normal or abnormal. And at last, 18 to 20 weeks of gestation, we can do a cordocentesis or pre-umbilical blood sampling. This is very difficult technique, you know very well. So it is very sophisticated and a difficult technique. If there is any failure or any problem during the extraction of the cord blood, then it can lead to a failure of the death of the baby. So this chromosomal evaluation in prenatal diagnosis can be subdivided into two parts. First is non-invasive, where we need not to insert any needle. And first, in that non-invasive technique, first is fetal cells from maternal blood. This is very new technique and which is being used very widely in all over the world. Second is pre-implantation genetic diagnosis, where we need not to insert any needle or anything inside the body. We can take out the eggs and we can do the testing in the laboratory. And second part is invasive technique, where we have to insert the needle and we have to insert catheter or anything to extract the cells or amniotic fluid or cord blood or placental tissue to achieve a chromosome pattern. So just to give you a pictorial way that how the culture can be done in our laboratory, chorionic villus sampling can be done through the ultrasound guidance, and then with the proper guidance, proper expert hands, we can take out the placental cells, and that can be extracted. In this second part, you can see how in a dissecting microscope we can remove the other parts, decidual parts or fat parts from the chorionic villus, and then we can achieve a trophoblast cells, and then we can culture it. Second part is amniocentesis, where in expert hands we can take out the amniotic fluid through the needle, and then this amniotic fluid will be of pale color. We can centrifuge it. After centrifugation, we can achieve good cells at the bottom of the tubes, and that cells can be cultured, and then we can see the chromosome pattern. And what we see inside the flask? So you can see the first panel shows adequate growth, means if there is everything fine, if there is a proper condition given to the cells, then cell starts adhering to the bottom of the flask. This is the characteristic feature of our animal cells, of our human cells. So it will go and attach to the flask of bottom of the flask. And then when there is adequate growth, 80 to 90% of confluency achieved, then we take out the cells with a particular technique called as trypsinization, and then we can take out the chromosomes from these cells. So how can prenatal diagnosis be useful? Managing the remaining weeks of the pregnancy. So if you know that there is an abnormality, then couples may decide to go for abortions or anything. Determining the outcome of the pregnancy, whether they are ready to receive a child with abnormality, that depends on the couple. Planning for possible complication with the birth process. Planning for problems that may occur in the newborn infant, and deciding whether to continue the pregnancy, they can decide, and finding condition that may affect future pregnancies. So if there is a balanced translocation seen in the baby, then we suggest that parental karyotype can be done. So in parental karyotype, if mother has that particular balanced translocation, so we can counsel them ki you should not go for next pregnancy, because that particular balanced translocation will come to your next offspring, and this can also lead to a chromosomal abnormality, and then ultimately you have an abnormal baby. So thank you for hearing me, and any queries you can contact me. This is my contact numbers, and we have a lab numbers. So ultimately I just give you a message that we have to save embryo, we have to save a child, and that we are here to help you in this way. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Saurabh. We have few queries. Dr. S.B. Singh from Delhi is asking about the clinical indications for chromosome analysis. What are the clinical indications for?
Clinical indications in the sense for prenatal diagnosis?
Yeah.
Okay, so clinical indications are lots, because ultimately we always get support from the ultrasonography findings, because if ultrasonography shows abnormal facial features or polydactyly or abnormal fingers or anything, or you know, cleft palate or cleft lip, then we should go for the prenatal diagnosis. Depends on what age it has been detected, whether it is detected in 10 to 12 weeks or later on, then we can decide whether we can go for chorionic villus, we can decide whether we can go for amniotic fluid and then cord blood. So that can be decided upon.
Okay. Dr. Prerna from Bareilly is asking, in fish testing, are we giving indications for trisomy 15 as well?
Trisomy 15 is very rare. Actually, it is shown that trisomy 15 is not a possible cause of failure of the embryo or failure of the baby. So trisomy 15 is not a very accepted cause for the failures. So,
and
but
so we are not doing it.
That's what we are not doing. So major probes contains 13, 18, 21 X and Y.
These are the fish probes which we are doing. Okay. So another question is, are we doing high-resolution karyotyping?
Yeah, we are doing high-resolution karyotyping. High-resolution karyotyping is a very good technique, but it needs lots of expertise, where in metaphase chromosome, instead of going for metaphase chromosome, where we can see short chromosomes, we can arrest the cells before metaphase chromosome, where we can achieve a long chromosomes, and even small microdeletion or duplication can be detected. So that is very good technique we are doing in our laboratory.
What is Prader-Willi syndrome, and are we doing at Dr. Lal PathLabs doing any tests for the
same? Prader-Willi syndrome is one of the possible cause for mental retardation in the babies, where chromosome 15, region of chromosome 15 is getting affected. There is a deletion present in that particular chromosome. So there are two things, Prader-Willi syndrome and Angelman syndrome. These both syndromes happening due to a deletion in chromosome number 15. But Prader-Willi syndrome has been inherited through a father. Angelman syndrome has been inherited through a mother. So that cannot be ruled out by fish technique, but we are doing to detect whether this deletion is present on that particular chromosome or not.
Dr. Pandey from Rohini is asking how chromosome and genome analysis is done using microarrays. Basically, out of cytogenetics,
okay,
it's microarray.
Microarray is very new technique where there are particular chips present in the market where we have to. There are already probes present in those particular chips, and it has been marked for all the possible genes present in our body, and then we can use the DNA. We can put a DNA in that particular chip, and then wherever there is a deletion, we can see a red color. Where there is a gain of the chromosome, we can see a green color. And where there is a normal, we can see a yellow color. So simultaneously, we can see whole genome in one particular chip. So this is very good technique.
Dr. I.S. Gambhir from Delhi is asking, please brief about the molecular cytogenetic diagnosis and somatic genome variations.
Molecular cytogenetics is nothing but a fish technique. So here, instead of going for chromosomes, we can directly take the interface cells and we can probe the DNA with the particular fluorescent probes, and we can detect the abnormality. This is molecular cytogenetics. Somatic cells, I am not very sure. We have to find out.
Dr. Deepika Goyal from Nagpur is asking about brief about chromosomal analysis test type. Again, she wants to know about the chromosomal analysis. We can.
It is just, so the same thing can be shared with her.
That can be shared with her. Thank you, Dr. Saurabh. We have few questions for Dr. Rita as well. Dr. Deepshika from Nagpur, she is asking, how much percentage rate is the success for IVF?
Now, the success rate of IVF, as I said, depends on many, many factors, and it will be difficult to give a comprehensive success rate, but it will all depend on the age. So I think that the most important factor is the age of the woman. If she is less than 35, worldwide the success rate is around 32 to 40%, but the moment the woman is from 36 to say 38, it reduces to around 30%. And from 38 to 40, it becomes drastically reduced to around 20%. And from 40 years onwards, it's really speaking 5%, 3 to 5%. Okay.
Dr. Prerna from Saharanpur, she is asking, what will be the line of test for recurrent abortions as traditionally it has been done? Torch, LA, APL, and advancement. So what needs to be done?
So recurrent spontaneous abortions, we really speak call it when there are loss of around 3 pregnancies consecutively. That's when the word recurrent spontaneous abortion is used. And again, going by it, you start with seeing the anatomy, first of all, doing a very good ultrasound, see whether there are any septa, because that's something which is really missed. So a good ultrasound in the beginning, along with her hormonal profile, which includes her FSH, LH, her prolactin, her thyroid, a hemoglobin A1C. So trying to rule out these disorders, which, so thyroid and diabetes are something which are, you know, in the latent stage missed out. After ruling out anatomical abnormalities in the uterus and the hormonal and the endocrinological abnormalities, I think then looking at the chromosomes and looking at whether there are some balanced translocations which are usually missed in case of recurrent spontaneous. Of course, at the immune level, looking at the antibodies. So antiphospholipid antibodies, looking at the lupus anticoagulant and the anticardiolipin antibodies, it is important to look at the immune complexes, which again may be one of the causes. And that is why maybe low dose aspirin and heparin, especially in cases of immune disorders as well as thrombophilias, have found good acceptance among these patients.
There is Dr. Dinesh Patnaik from Firozpur. He has a case. He is asking, in a miscarriage was due to Patau's. So what genetic counseling should he give to for future pregnancy to the couple? 35 years female and 39 years male. So for Patau's.
The first thing we have to rule out is parental karyotype, as I told, that whether this chromosome 13 is de novo or inherited by the parents. So that is the first line of thinking. Now, if there is no abnormality seen in the parents, then it cannot be ruled out. So that must be a de novo abnormality came to the baby.
Now, the session is open for the live audience as well. For any questions from the live audience, yeah, please. One by one, we can ask.
Ovarian cyst of 8 to 10 centimeters, ovarian cyst.
Well, if it is an 8 to 10 centimeter, and as I said, it's important to rule out it's a simple cyst or a complex cyst. So that means, are there any, it is just a simple cyst means it has no contents, or has it got any solid contents? If you can see solid contents, especially if you can see fat, calcium, so you think it may be a dermoid cyst, then it is a different thing. If you think it's a solid tumor, or if you think it's a simple cyst. Now, if it is a simple cyst, but is 8 to 10 centimeter, definitely requires intervention, and laparoscopically removing the cyst would be the less than 3 to 5 centimeter, one can leave them and just watch them, give them a contraceptive pill, suppress the ovary and suppress the cyst, which may vanish.
Yes, sir.
What's the upper age limit? Upper age limit for IVF? For both
upper
male
age
and
limit for
IVF? For both male and female.
Now, there is no set defined upper age limit for IVF, so it is open for males. Of course, there is absolutely no defined age because there is not too much of a difference in the count. There is a little bit, but not that much to warrant any putting an age cap for males. As far as women are concerned, as I said, the egg count really decreases, but if one is open for egg donation or surrogacy, then there is really speaking, at the moment ICIM has not put an age limit for doing an IVF cycle. So we still get women of 45, 50 years and successfully carrying on pregnancies because they are willing for egg donation. So once you have a younger egg combined with the husband's sperm, and if her uterus can be reactivated by giving her a pill to bleed, so once she bleeds for about 3 months, then she can be ripened, her estrogens can be given to ripen her endometrium, and an IVF cycle done with a donor egg is successful. So since IVF is coming of age now, there are so many women who may have wanted to become pregnant previously, but missed on the bus, are now ready to come. So really speaking, no age.
So, and the age, the morphology of the sperms, does it change with the age?
Some of these studies, there has been seen some change in the aging of the sperm, as it is said. But let me say that God has been kind to men and been unkind to women in that manner.
What's the maximum number of cycles?
Tuberculosis being very common in our country. A number of tests which you are doing routinely, most important test to rule out tuberculosis before IVF?
So, routine testing like ESR and looking at the X-ray chest and doing a TB gold test, which I think is a good test, especially before IVF, trying to rule out. But doing an endometrial biopsy or doing a TB PCR, which I think is come out, is of age now. And I think Dr. Atima, you'll agree with me on that.
Yes, yes.
So TB PCR, I think, will be the best.
Will be the best test. Best.
Ma'am, just to enlighten on that, we would recommend TB gold first, so that it has a very good negative predictive value. So if you are going to have a TB gold first, and if it is negative, you can rule out the tuberculosis. But if it is positive, then you can proceed further with endometrial biopsies for PCR as well as culture.
If the endometrial biopsy is negative, your test is positive, would you like to put the patient on ATT?
Ma'am, if the PCR is positive, yes, definitely.
Well, in India, it is so rampant that, you know, we are sometimes even, I mean, although it is not the right way to do it, but in repeated failures or in long infertility and with whatever, look at endometritis, alpingitis scene, we do sometimes give an empirical course of, although that is not the right
maybe
way.
Maybe mycoplasma is there or other disorders are there which can be treated by ATT. That is the thing. Yes, sir.
The maximum number of cycles we can subject a woman to?
The number of IVF cycles?
Yeah,
well,
maximum.
Again, there is just no limit. It will depend on your patience, on your perseverance, and on your finance.
So what is the cost factor in chromosomal evaluation? Should we start from chromosomal study first, or should we start from the maternal side first?
I feel maternal side screening is the first thing. And then if there is an abnormality, then we should go for chromosome analysis. And if you talk about the cost, the chromosome analysis as such is a lower cost, 2,000 to 3,000 in the range. But if you go for FISH or molecular cytogenetic analysis, the cost increases. It will go for 6,000 and 7,000 or later on till 40,000 for microarrays and all sophisticated tests.
Thanks a lot.
Congratulations to all the presenters for the excellent presentation. I'll just like to know in detail about isochromosomes and derivative chromosomes, as you highlighted in your slide.
Yeah.
What is the clinical relevance for an obstetrician and a gynecologist?
Yeah, so isochromosome actually is mainly we have seen isochromosomes in a patient with amenorrhea or kind of a patient with a Turner syndrome associated with sexual abnormalities or hormonal disbalances. So we have seen isochromosome in that. Isochromosome X have been seen. So in that way, 2X chromosome has got deleted from the centromere and they have rejoined each other. Okay, so ultimately there is a loss of some genes, whatever present in the P arm of the chromosome. So that is, obviously that is a difficulty and that is a dangerous part of for the Turner syndrome patients. So isochromosome basically is seen in a Turner syndrome patients.
Derivative
chromosome can be seen in any patients, any particular clinical significance. There is no particular patient where we can see derivative chromosome. Derivative chromosome is a chromosome which can form by more than two aberrations. Suppose in one particular chromosome there is a deletion happened, and immediately after deletion there is a translocation happened with other chromosome. So in one particular chromosome, if there is a more than two abnormalities seen, that is called as derivative chromosome.
Cystic fibrosis.
Yeah, that is actually cystic fibrosis. It's a mutation test molecular.
Cystic fibrosis, I think it is not related to infertility as
because when there is congenital abscess,
vast difference.
Yeah, but it is congenital more. It is more in congenital rather than detecting it pre.
No, if the patient doesn't have vast difference.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. So that is true. So in congenital absence of vas deferens, one should suspect cystic fibrosis. And there is a gene which is for, especially for cystic fibrosis mutation, which has to be tested. But I really do have no idea
but,
on how the test
at is. At present, we are not, we are not doing as per day. For
but depends on, the request.
For the request, yeah.
Do it. Yeah, there are lots of studies present in.
What are the abnormalities they generally
quote? Most of the PCOD and PCOS studies have shown the chromosomal abnormalities in the X chromosome. So whether X chromosome is getting imbalanced translocation with any other chromosome, or if there is a deletion or translocation within the X chromosome.
Why is the incidence rising?
That is because I would say that because of maybe a lifestyle and increased age of the mother.
Dr. Nisha is asking from Jaipur, what is the life of sperms in female uterus after IUI?
So the sperm is alive for about 24 hours and the egg stays alive for about 48 hours. So that is how, whether it is IUI or natural, it remains the same.
Dr. Abha is asking to confirm a test after trisomy 21 is positive if the patient does not want to go for amniocentesis. What test would the person do for trisomy 21 positivity?
So it is related to prenatal diagnosis?
Yeah.
So first thing is triple marker test. So if triple marker test is showing high positivity, then we should go for
MBFD. We should go in for
MBFD. For non-invasive.
That is maternal blood fetal DNA, we should go in for
yes,
that.
Yes.
Because it
so
is
it depends on the patient how they are choosing their own diagnosis. So if they are choosing, okay. But MDFD is also a, you know, it is like costly test. If they can afford, definitely they can go for MBFD. That is the best thing. But the cheaper way, we can come down with an invasive test.
But
like
they, are asking, case, they
I,
are asking.
I think what they mean to say is if you think that if some of the ultrasound soft markers are there showing a trisomy 21, then what you should go is either you go for amniocentesis, which is a definitive test thing, or a non-invasive test, which is now available.
That is MBFD, which is available. And it is giving a 99.9% correlation with the amniocentesis.
So a blood test, which can be done between 10 to 24 weeks can now definitely rule out whether any
because and because it is a next gen sequencer, so any abnormality in the genome, complete genome, can be detected by this MBFD test.
And then if they are ready to go for amniotic fluid karyotyping or FISH, that depends on them, but FISH gives a result very fast and amniotic fluid culture takes lots of time. So, but it gives a definitive result. If there is a, suppose if there is a trisomy 21 involved in some other chromosome balance translocation, that cannot be ruled out by FISH. So that can be ruled out by karyotyping only. So there is a difference in the tests and techniques that physician
has to
decide. The
problem I think is only of time because you know, when it is 18 to 20
first.
Weeks, when a good ultrasound is detecting all the anomalies and then doing a test, it takes about 4 to 6 weeks for the result.
That is why the DNA test, which is non-invasive, is much better than other invasive tests. That is the thing. Dr. Deepa Gupta from Delhi is asking, how long of a wait is recommended between a failed IVF cycle and trying again?
A minimum of 3 months is important before one can try another cycle. So that is a minimum. Of course, it is good to have about 6 months gap between two cycles.
Dr. Shruti from Lucknow is asking, 24 years female with ultrasound is suggestive of having cysts, 6 centimeters. Should it be operated or supplemented with OCP?
So as I think we've discussed this question two, three times now. 6 centimeter is, so 3 to 5 is what theoretically books say. That one can subject to OC pills. After that, they require removal.
For Dr. Saurabh, it is Dr. Nisha Desai, and she is asking, if a couple has 2 male child with autism, what would we advise for the couple, basically? Autism.
Yeah, first of all, autism, we have seen that chromosome 7 is involved in autism, autistic features, autistic patients, autistic babies. So whether there is a deletion in chromosome 7 or there is a translocation involved with the chromosome 7, that can be ruled out by baby's karyotyping, obviously. And if there is a balanced translocation present, then definitely we should go for parental karyotype to rule out, and then we can counsel them.
But if they want to have another baby.
That's what. Parental
so
karyotype is
pre,
must.
Pre can be done.
Yeah.
So once you have a parental karyotype telling a chromosome if it is defective, whether it is in the male or the female,
exactly,
then again you have the option of changing the sperm.
The change,
yes,
yeah.
Yes, then they can
finally answer. The IVF. Any other questions? Yeah.
Anyway, diagnose prenatal albinism. Is there some way to find out? I have seen one case, there are no family
albinism
history, nothing, prenatal albinism.
Yeah, there are mutation tests available actually for albinism that can be ruled out by PCR techniques, but not in a chromosome level, because we can see a normal chromosome in albinism. But in a PCR, in a mutation detection, we can do that.
How should we send it to your lab? In saline or?
Yeah, the recommended transport medium is saline. If you have some antibiotic, you can put some antibiotic so that there would be no chance of contamination. And then it will be in a sterile container and it can reach to a lab. Just 2 grams of chorionic villus or placental tissue is enough. And if you do not have placental tissue, then skin biopsy sample, 2 centimeter of the skin biopsy from any part of the baby is okay, enough for culture.
Okay, and the parental blood for karyotyping,
heparinized.
How much we should send?
Heparin is vacutainer,
okay.
Green top.
How do you extract fetal DNA from maternal blood?
How do
you process it? And what are the ways in which we can send the maternal blood for fetal DNA analysis?
MBFD technique.
It is basically MBFD in which we are doing next-gen sequencing.
So DNA can be extracted through maternal blood, and the fetal cells, whatever present in the maternal blood, can be extracted out first. And that can go for next generation sequencing. And there is some kind of bioinformatics work to be done to analyze, and then finally we can say whether it is having a...
It is basically all the chromosomes, whichever are there, the complete genome is scanned by the next-gen sequencer.
Complete genome contains some like major genes, like 300 to 400 genes are there. So that all can be detected altogether for any mutation present in the baby.
Is it available in Delhi, and what will be the approximate cost?
It is 35,000, and we are doing it with us. If you want, we can provide you with the tubes and the sample can be sent. And the turnaround time is 10 days. Any other questions? Yeah, we are not doing it ourselves, we are sending it outside.
China or Japan?
We are sending it to Japan.
Okay.
Yeah. The last question.
Yeah.
What is the upper limit for amniocentesis? Dr. Mishra from Jaipur is asking. Upper limit for amniocentesis.
Upper limit
for the age for amniocentesis.
So as an abortion, I think you can do it till 20 weeks. So if that becomes the upper limit till when you can do an amniocentesis.
I think thanks from the audience for excellent presentation.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Rita and Dr. Saurabh. All the
for the webinar people. Any other question, if there is, we'll be answering them later on. Thank you. And for the live audience, the lunch is ready.